Before I request my colleagues to ask areas of clarification, there is one issue which we need, because as a committee, we are supposed to oversee your progress on SDGs. And as a committee, we are not being capacitated what SDGs are. You have in your ministry, so one day update for your comment with the progress that have been made so far in the implementing SDGs in the plan, because we also want to make a plan of how we are going to perform or how we are going to supervise
our ministry.
Yes, and before I go deep into issue, into further issues, we also talked about the program which we have to know. We want to give us the issue on a legislative program to fulfill this term. I feel that we need, as a committee, to be capacitated earlier than actually trying to hunt for info and for progress. We have to be capacitated earlier so that we work together at the same time. So we are requesting if something can be done to capacitate this committee on that issue. So on the issue of SDGs, on the issue on legislative procedures. And then I noted a few things on STEM. We have concentrated on supporting pupils. A-level pupils in STEM subjects, and now we are looking at the tune of around 10,000 from 2,500. But these students are coming from developed institutions which have been existing in the rural communities. There are no labs. There's no capacity to train this or to teach the STEM subject. So as a committee, we feel this money for the ZIMDEL can't be used to capacitate the rural areas in construction of laboratories to facilitate or build the capacity of this, because that's the area which is lacking. And another issue I picked is last year around December, our minister gave a statement, a policy statement that we can now shift to give that graduate loans for a loan for students. In the budget, at the moment, there's nothing. So at the time being, before we have a common thing, what's going to happen to the students who can afford it? Because there's nothing budgeted for in this year's budget. But another area needs some input. We also noted that at the moment, even people graduating in STEM issues like engineers, they are roaming around the street, they are not employed. Can this fund or the thing to find or find available, can it be used to capacitate these research institutions like the CED or institutions which deal with these SMEs, so that at least these STEM graduates are brought to the community? They just want more and producing more and more, but more and more are going to the street. So somewhere, can we have a policy where this man should have written to this state institutions, so that maybe. These graduates can be absorbed into the mainstream economy. If they have the respondents on those issues, tightened before I open it to my colleagues.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. With regard to the SDGs, thank you for flagging the issue. With your indulgence, I wish, because of its importance, it had been included there, then we would have brought the relevant information in the same way that we did with the items before you, because it is very important. If you don't mind, may I promise that following this presentation or hearing, we can submit to the committee a detailed report on this. And I think we can do it by next Monday. But it will be highlighting SDG on the quality of education on the gender equality and on industry, innovation and infrastructure, which we kind of talked about in particular. But if that is acceptable to you, I request that we handle that one, because I agree with you, it's a very important one. And if you had asked me on Wednesday in Parliament, I would have said, put it in writing. But thank you for your accommodation on that. Then the very important issue that we agree with you, Honorable Chair, is that given the fact that there are these processes going on which will have implications on policy changes as well as legislative changes, it is important that you be capacitated. And we think this is an issue. I actually happily heard when we were reviewing this last week that ZIMDEF is in the process of, after they appeared here, I don't know whether a similar issue was raised. So on their own, they've made a suggestion to me as the ZIMDEF trustee to capacitate the committee to look at the work they've done. For example, they supported the higher and tertiary education institutions, science and technology development centers as well, to something around 25 million or so last year. And they would like you to see that in action so that you have the evidence-based results of the work. But along with that, we think it's important for you to visit our universities and institutions such as Verify Engineering at Feruka, who are doing quite some cutting-edge research with concrete industry implications on renewable energy. And so we agree. We think that through the permanent secretary, we will ask that there be some communication with yourselves and the clerk of parliament to make it possible as soon as possible. That will try and get going this week, because it's very important. Then when we engage and meet, you will also be speaking from an independent point of view in terms of how you have assessed what is this?
That's the dates that they
Okay, but they will write to suggest a mutually convenient time as to when that should happen, depending on your schedule. The 10,000, I said, Honorable Chair, is simply adding last year's group and this year's group. It's a targeted group, and it's an important initiative. We want to continue with it until 2026. But you make the right observation, which should concern both policy and the police side and parliament, especially through your committee, that, well, are these not coming from well-developed schools and so forth? Well, they are, but remember, they were few, and the few, or majority of the few, were being scouted by foreign universities, getting in and so forth. So this is an intervention that's specific. But the honest truth, which our colleagues in the Ministry of Primary and Secondary Education have said as a result of the new curriculum, is that schools need to be capacitated, especially the rural schools. In the past, as honorable members are aware, no school would be a high school, secondary school, would be, what's the word, not licensed or authorized, you know, like, what's the word, that do schools don't get, is it registration? Do schools get registered? Yes. Or no school will be approved, you know? What's the word, licensed, approved, registered, approved? Eh? Upgraded?
Registered.
Registered. No school will be registered without a lab. It was a requirement. But now communities build schools, no laboratory, no workshops. They just get approved through various responsible authorities, churches, communities themselves, local rural district councils, and so forth. I hope we can have committees like yours and your counterpart or sister committee to say, can we be strict about those things? Can we go back? Because it will address this very important issue that you are raising. There is little that we can do. Honorable Chair, we can't use ZIMDEF funds to build those schools and put labs in those schools. We can't, really. We will face all sorts of problems from our colleagues there, but we also face problems from tertiary and higher education institutions which don't have labs. The ZIMDEF mandate is to develop high-end skills. The only reason we went to those A levels is their recruitment for high-end skills. The ZIMDEF fund is also a very limited fund. Industry wants to see a red relationship between the skills that are produced for industry and that 1% levy. It's not for primary and secondary school. So we recognize the problem, but there is not much we can do through ZIMDEF fund. We also appreciate that the Minister of Primary and Secondary Education recognizing the same problem that you highlight, Honorable Chair, has come up with kits, science kits, for those schools that don't have labs. There's a program to try and put labs there. There is an infrastructure development program for primary and secondary schools which will prioritize those things, and it involves the IBTZ. But they are also at least temporarily using these kits. I was surprised, I don't know what the situation is in other constituencies, but when we were doing an audit in Toronto North, we found that some schools had put the kits in some dark rooms, piled, and locked them up, not using. And maybe sometimes it's because they don't have the science teachers and so forth. But government at least has taken some interim measures to deal with that question. But otherwise, yes, the rural areas have these challenges about labs. We thought we could encourage a response which was going to take advantage of the A-level situation in ZIMDEF to come up with a district. I thought, where is Mr. Did you give me the report? No. Well, I can't allow him to speak. He hasn't taken an oath here. But the closest we are coming to that situation in the rural areas is to find centers of excellence, like a school that is already reasonably well equipped, but which we can, an A-level school, which we can then beef up, modernize, and say, please service the whole district as a center. So this is the closest that we are going to do, and we think that we can have a $3 million or so dollar project from ZIMDEF to intervene in rural places in that way. And then, yes, Honorable Chair, we did announce a policy initiative that seeks to respond to the difficulties parents and guardians are facing to support their children and largely the same population group from rural areas who enroll at our universities. The majority of our universities enroll students from marginalized poor families, rural families who have insufficient income to pay the tuition fees. Because of the difficulties that are obvious to everyone, but especially honorable members of parliament, in terms of the shrinking budget, we can't have a grant scheme to say just there you are going. The golden days of grants at the University of Zimbabwe, when it was the only university, are behind us now. But we can have a loan scheme that expresses confidence in the student to say you have chosen the right field, to say you have a legitimate expectation to get a job after you get a skill, and so you can get a loan and come up with a repayment plans once the student is employed. So we spoke of and are working on a loan scheme. We are surprised that the media keep using the word grant. We never said that, and we are not going to say that. This is not an economy for grants, but it is an economy for loans, and the loan scheme requires that people work hard, and we would like that scheme to be accessible to just about every student at tertiary and higher education. Because it's a loan scheme, it can't come out of the budget. We are working with the Reserve Bank as well as a microfinance institution that has been identified by the Reserve Bank to come up with this. We obviously said, as we were speaking in December, this will be next year, by which we meant 2017. But we didn't say January 2017 or February 2017. We thought it would be taken as understood or given that the academic year for these institutions starts in August. So we're working flat out now to put it in place in time for August, but well ahead of August. And when we have the full document, again, we will share it with you. But it's not in the budget because it's not a grant. It's not a fiscal allocation. It's a loan. Then lastly, Honorable Chair, you say that why are you focusing on this 10,000 and talking about STEM and new engineers? Meanwhile, there are many out there who are unemployed, the engineers. Well, they are not stematized, number one. Number two, we don't work on former graduates. That's not our job, although the question is a national question. We educate those who are coming in and those who will come in. So if we made mistakes in the past about those who went through, we are correcting them for those who are coming in and those who are going to be coming in. As for those who are there, it's the employers out there in public. It's the Public Service Commission. Ask them why they are not employing those engineers who are out there, and then the others. But I think part of the problem is that really, these streets in Harare in this rainy season became rivers. Where are our engineers? I mean, they can't just say we should employ them on the basis of pieces of papers, you know. They have to provide technological and engineering solutions, you know. And if they are not doing, they have themselves to blame. They have to go back to school. You know, so rather than even thinking broadly of civil engineers, we want road engineers, pothole engineers. You know, because this is what our country is experiencing. Thank you very much, Honourable Chair.
Thank you very much, Chair. Minister, I've got a few questions that I have as in follow-up to what you have said.
Yes, I'm listening.
Yes. The state program consumed over $7 million last year. That those are the figures were given by Zimbabwe. And if I divide 7 million by 10 provinces, that's about 700,000. And 700,000 really goes down to school. That's quite a lot of money. And also, I was really impressed by the quality of the documents that you produce for everything. You know, I'm really impressed.
Thank you. It's
qualitative documents you're producing. But obviously, I think they also consume quite a lot of money. Mm-hmm. My question regarding that is, if we had put that $7 million into infrastructure development that enables STEM, would that not have made a much bigger difference compared to really dwelling on paying of school fees? And how do you make sure that those students who are stigmatized don't leave the country? Because I think your major problem was that all those that have been produced before, the good ones, are also leaving the country. Related to that, Minister, is that most of our universities are no longer attracting the elite students. They are all now leaving the country. Most ministers and MPs, all the business people and so forth, children don't go to universities, local universities, because they are no longer attractive. They are stigmatizing elsewhere. What are you doing as the ministry to ensure that every student goes to higher tertiary education institutions in Zimbabwe? I can give you some figures. Per year, Zimbabwe is spending $20 million on school fees for school students that are studying outside. Parents are paying $20 million to universities outside. And if that money was actually being used on upgrading our own universities, creating, you know, correct boarding facilities or accommodation facilities, infrastructure and so forth, surely that would make a difference for our nation. And then the other thing is that at primary and secondary education, we have Group A, Group B schools, which means I can choose to take my child to a school that pays, where I pay 3,500, because the quality of education there, the facilities and everything are in terms of what I want. Why don't you also have universities like that, where people can afford to pay $3,000 per semester? And they have got an university in Zimbabwe where they can pay that 3,000 instead of paying to Malaysia, to America, Britain, and so on. And the money is being retained in Zimbabwe. My last question. You have said the curriculum is not, you have not done anything in terms of lecturers changing their mentality, the stigmatizing the lecturers themselves. And you said that is nothing has been done except you are really working on the pipeline to feed into universities. What guarantee do we have that STEM will be successful at that level to produce an engineer, a portal engineer, whatever engineer that you are designing or thinking of producing later on in future, when in actual fact the correct source itself of producing that particular engineer has not been stigmatized itself? Those are my places.
Thank you, Chairman. Minister Moyo, the delegation, would like to thank you so much for coming to us. There is a lot that we have heard from you, maybe which we didn't hear in that fashion before. But as your committee, when there is a problem in the ministry, is there anything that bars you from requesting for an audience with the committee so that we get some of these things first hand from the ministry than to read it from the papers? Than to read.
No, sorry, I haven't said.
Okay. All these things that at the end of the presentation you tried to inform us about, we only got those through the papers. And we, if anybody had asked us what was actually going on in the ministry that we superintend, we didn't have answers. So I think we should have constant interaction even before things really get out of control. On stigmatizing, I just wanted to go a step further and say your committee, Honorable Minister, right now we've been having a presentation and all of us are having mountains of paper, yet our Ministry of Science and Technology at the end. We are also hopeful that when you source computers or laptops, you can also think of this computer, this committee, so that when you are presenting and somebody comes in, they actually see that we are stigmatized as well, and we are science and technology ambassadors. Otherwise, I'd like to end up by saying thank you very much, Minister. A lot of hazy things have been cleared by your presentation. Thank you, Chairman.
My team, if you would actually say your names before you present.
Also, the way you're going, you're asking everyone, Honorable Chair. Okay, no, that's fine.
Any more contributions? Input from your team?
Is that one?
Yeah, it came right through.
Oh, sorry.
Final from. So, yeah, my colleague.
Okay, thank you, Chair. I'm Adam Chimamrombe, MD for Chipinga West. I thank you, Minister, for your presentation. And I'm glad that you're stigmatizing everyone, right from the secondary schools, but not actually in between the ones that are in the process of becoming engineers. Mr. Minister, are we going to stigmatize those as well, or we just leave them as they are? They're not getting attachments to any companies, and we have problems of these students being able to go and research on their studies. I thought you, as a tertiary minister, who is responsible for these tertiary institutions, are going to stigmatize these as well, as they are still in the process.
Sorry, these are which ones?
The ones that are in the colleges right now. The ones that are training to be engineers, the ones that are training to be doctors. And all sorts of things. And my other question is, before you started this agenda for stigmatization, did you carry out a research that was approved by the institutions that were there at the time, that are in existence? I heard you say that it is very difficult to run institutions with the monies or finances that are coming from the students that are paying for the paying fees to these institutions. But I see most of my colleagues here and some of the entrepreneurs are actually going into education and building schools. It has become a fashion that when you are maybe a member of parliament, you also have a school there. And I wonder now how they are running these institutions when you say it's impossible to run these institutions using school fees from the students. I think that's it. Thank you.
If I would allow another minister to respond to the concerns of the team.
Thank you. Well, Honorable Jaya didn't hear concerns. I had support from the Honorable members, which support we appreciate, support from our committee. The Honorable Deputy Chair, the Honorable Chakora, asked several questions. But the first one was about him calculating that we must have spent around 7 million last year on STEM.
That is what he said.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, I was. Yes, yes. No, noted from the same presentation. Whenever you launch a program, the first time you do it, it costs a lot of money. And if you look at that, you will see that, as you will indeed recall, if you reflect and think back, Honorable Deputy Chair, that there was quite some massive outreach and publicity across media platforms. And it was important to communicate and to do everything possible to reach every prospective O-level student in urban areas and up country. Also, to reach the schools, to reach the parents, the guardians, and that accounts for an expenditure which would have otherwise been lower than 7 million. You will see next year that this year we have not, there is an outreach program, but it's not as intensive and expensive as the one that we did last year. And in 2018, I think it will now be common cause that this is information known to the communities and so forth. So it was unavoidable, necessary, in our view. I appreciate that you say our work is in, you know, impressive documents and so forth. We need to do that as higher education. We need to set the bar. And I hope it's not just that it's glossy looking nice, but that the content is substantive, which we believe it is. We spend a lot of time thinking through our work, and we think that it is only fair that its packaging should become commensurate to the time and thinking that we spend. Yes, it costs something, but we are increasingly stigmatizing ourselves as well. When you are fully stigmatized, the cost is reduced. We would like, in agreement with you, a situation where not only are we stigmatized, but you are also stigmatized, and we don't have this much paperwork. We would like a paperless interaction, so that, you know, whether it's iPads or computers or some other platforms and devices, we can have that exchange of information. And because you have raised that issue, I think it's you, Honorable Deputy Chair, who asked me to capacitate you and all the directors headed by the Permanent Secretary are here. They've heard this. I'm hoping that I will get a request tomorrow to capacitate a committee that is 10 member committee. we will do that because we think it's right that we do that. Actually, we are working on a higher education information management system, and we will want you to be hooked into that as everyone else who is in the sector. And then there are levels of, because it will include all our institutions, and a certain information can be accessed by people depending on various levels of authority. We don't access academic information, for example, results and things. But we will do that and make sure that you are part of that system. Your suggestion, though, that this money could have been used for infrastructure development, we can understand that. But that would not have been an initiative. That would not have been a policy, because that, you can always do that any other time. That's not the intervention we sought to do. You will recall, Honorable Deputy Chair, that we said the A-level STEM initiative was a direct response to a small pool of students with STEM or science foundations coming into our universities. It was only 2,500. That was presented to us as a serious problem, and indeed it is a serious problem. So we were solving that problem. You can't solve that problem by building things. You know, it would be like that example I gave of going to the side where there's light when you should look where there is no light. You know, remember, every initiative must be judged and measured against the problem it is solving. And when you single out one problem, it doesn't mean you think it's the only problem. There is the other issue. But here, we wanted to grow the pool of students coming from A-level into our universities with the right grade. And we think we will start seeing that from next year in 2018. But we agree with you that there is an infrastructural development problem. That's why, since last year, as announced by the Honorable Minister of Finance in the 2016 budget, we've been working on an infrastructure bond for higher and tertiary education institutions to address the problem of accommodation, student accommodation, staff accommodation, learning facilities, teaching facilities, and so forth. We are very close, all going well, from rolling out that initiative, which will now be dealing with what you are talking about, because we didn't ignore it. We think that we need a bond of some $2 billion or so. And we've had to work scrupulously with various stakeholders, and that process is at the tail end. But you do ask, and rightly so, that if you are targeting the A-level students with those STEM foundational subjects, what makes you think that they will stay? They will not continue to be recruited or scouted by foreign universities? Well, that's why we are taking them to Silicon Valley, and we will take them to other valleys in South Korea, China, and so Singapore, Malaysia, and work with our universities, especially the science universities, which I indicated we're working with them, to offer them before they finish. First to hold vacation STEM camps, and also to offer them full scholarships to study STEM. We are not bonding them, because we don't think that will work, but we are definitely incentivizing them, treating them like eggs, so that they will not think if they go elsewhere they will get that treatment. But this is work in progress, and if we can engage with you on what else we need to do to keep them, that will be good. But the infrastructure development fund, I mean the infrastructure fund for universities, for higher and tertiary education institutions, is designed to make, we must make these universities attractive. And if you go to our universities these days, and we invite you, I hope you actually do participate at least during the graduation ceremonies every year. They are beginning to look like universities, attractive, and you know, beautiful, and we're encouraging them to invest in looking nice, so that when people come and say, "Oh, what is this?" Even if you go to LSU, by the way, they have challenges. We said 78% of debtors there, according to the audited statement. But it looks nice, that university, when you go there. You'll be like, you know, want them to look nicer and have the facilities. That's what is going to attract students who pay $3,000. They don't go to ghost towns and ghost universities, you know, with broken everything and looking like prisons as opposed to looking like universities. But you can't do that overnight. You need a more systematic program. Both on the infrastructure side, on the lecturer side, have endowed chairs with some of the big names in the relevant fields that attract. You go there because there's professor and so who is renowned, and you can get that going through endowing a chair and giving scholarships and so forth. We think that the universities, you see, universities are microcosms of society. They should look cosmopolitan. They should have diversity. They should show an international outlook in the staffing as well as student bodies. That is what our competition, whether it's a Makerere University or University of Nairobi or University of Cape Town or the other universities. There are only 14 universities that are part of the top 800 universities in Africa. I mean, sorry, in the world, 14 from Africa. And obviously we're not featuring, we have 20 universities and none of them is in Africa's top 10 universities. So we need to work on that. It's infrastructure, it's staff, it's programs, content and so forth. But this is exactly what we are working on, Honorable Deputy Chair. And we are so sure that University of Zimbabwe over the next 5 years, if not less, will be up there. We are so sure about that. And we know, or at least believe, that once the University of Zimbabwe gets there, it will put pressure on the other universities. Some universities, MSU, GZU, CAT, will say, in certain fields, they are beginning to be up there. If you are just factored out a faculty or a department, but the work has to be the university as a whole. It's unfortunate that the economy is underperforming right now. But if there are institutions in our country which should be at the forefront of the reform of this economy, it should be our universities. Because that's where the thinking is takes place. There's what appears to be an obvious decline in capacity in the public service as well as in the private sector. But we would like to see quite some capacity at the university level. So we agree with you that you know things can be better and will be better. But we don't just want to compare things that are not comparable. I mean, if you tell us that 20 million is being spent outside by parents, well, first of all, we'll never force people not to send their kids outside through decrees, legislation, and so forth. There's something to be gained by having our students going in other countries, either because the parents are sending them, but also we have bilateral scholarships which we run in the ministry. In a number of foreign countries. At the moment, it's typically Russia, India, Algeria a lot, Cuba, and the Fulbright scholarships and all those are still there, and some of those traditional scholarships in countries like the UK and so forth. That's fine. But you are right that we should upgrade the level of our universities so that even those parents that think that their kids are better off at some of the foreign universities will send their kids here because the universities are ranked high. It's a question of raising the quality of those universities through their programs. And Honorable Machinkura, you I'm pleased to hear you basically, although you were saying, why did you not come to us? I hear you actually saying, next time you are in trouble, come to us. Don't wait until you know things get out of hand. Because the answer to why didn't you come to us is that we were subjected to a sage approach, you know, taken by storm when, you know, you see, you can only come if you think you are guilty and you have something to be afraid of. But when people boom, hit you like a storm, you kind of have to weather the storm before you start, you know. You would have lost the luxury of going to Tete or Ambuya, Kunochema, Ambuya, Wona, Zavarundi, and so forth. You've got to do what is necessary, that is before you. But that is partly why there were two things that we, you know, the approach to parliament we think was improper. And the use of documents stolen from a break-in we think is improper. And we have volunteered that information. And we hope there are going to be corrections because those things are just, they have nothing to do with any case. You know, it's simply a thuggery, chicanery that is not in the interest of our constitution or the rule of law, but more seriously, damaging to the education, say higher and tertiary education, science and technology development sector, as we you know. So at least we have come to you and leaving you with what we think is a problem that has not gone away. It needs to be resolved. And you did also echo the sentiment of capacitation of computers and sanitizing the committee. And this is something we are going to give priority as soon as we leave, so that, you know, it happens not only in terms of committee here, but also like the chair indicated, in terms of you accessing directly and independent of us the work that the sector that you supervise is doing. Honorable Chiparimombe. Chiwa?
Chiuma.
Oyo ndi asingaziwe. Anyo anyo asingaziwe. Unori piswa shamari. For Chiuma Mombe and Chiuma Murombe is not Chiparimombe. Chiuma Murombe. Thank you, comrade. Well, you are posing a challenge that the communities keep raising with us to say, why are you not stabilizing the current crop?
Yeah.
But if by the current crop you mean the students who are enrolled right now,
yeah,
clearly by signaling the direction, the policy direction, a lot is going on in our institutions. Where, if you see, when we were going around for the 2016 graduation ceremony season, all the colleges, their themes of the graduation themes were STEM. STEM this, STEM that. Their entertainment, dancing, the STEM. STEM songs, STEM yawuya. I think Japres have got the idea of Mdara Achawea from STEM Yahweh. So the current crop is not escaping, but the full policy and so forth, obviously, as we indicated to you, Honorable Member. Is kind of work in progress, but almost towards the end. But I can assure you, there is no way any student who is going now will not be stigmatized. But we will see the fruits as the program gets consolidated and advances. You ask, though, whether we carried any research before coming up with STEM. Well, we noted that other people before us carried research. You know, the idea that the president in 2013 put together the Ministry of Higher and Tertiary Education and Science and Technology Development was to stematize higher education. But the president did not do this just like boom. We also said that when we were now doing our program, His Excellency was chairman of SADC, and the better part of beneficiation and value addition of ZIMASET experience influenced the formulation of the SADC industrialization agenda, which is thematizing. And that was a huge process, and there was a lot of research done for that. But even more compelling, at the African Union side, education and training has been put together with science and technology. But there's a lot of experience there. Countries like us take advantage of the wisdom that comes out of regional organizations and continental. Basically, the multilateral process is very important also to inform what we are doing. But I also say, with respect to what we've actually decided and we are doing, which is the A-level STEM program, we are responding to what the universities experience, evidence-based, that we have a small pool of A-level students. Can we increase this pool so that we can discharge our mandate as science and technology institutions? That's evidence-based, Honorable Member. We are not like thumb-sucking that 2,500 available in 2014 was a real number. So that is research-based. But as to what we now must do and where we must go, we say we spent July 2015 to March 2016 interacting with 46 institutions, which is all of them. And we have come up with this compendium, which is a call for STEM. And we are now extracting the insights from it to design the policy in a more concrete way and reform the legislation. But you don't have the defined policy in a concrete way before you, and you don't have the legislative proposals yet. But you have the basis, and we've given it to you also. And we have said we are going to invite you and capacitate you to go and interact with our institutions, so that you will be part to the final discussion. So it's research driven. We don't do things that are not informed by the evidence on the ground. We have to be able to sustain what we are proposing with reference to the best practice and best knowledge or information at the time. Thank you, Honorable Chair.
Yes.
Sure. Let me check before. You said that you are surprised that I say the fees are not enough to run schools.
Yes.
And yet everyone. I didn't say schools, I said universities. Well, you know, a university
also starting colleges.
No, we are the ones who register them. We will not register them. I said, if they come and say we are a responsible authority and we want to establish a college or a university which will be run on the basis of tuition, we will not register. We will not.
Why?
Because it is a preposterous proposition. The economy will not support a thing like that. They have to say, we will raise money there to build this. And that's what they say. You know, the private universities in our country are 7 at the moment, or 6. Out of the 6, 5 are church-related. Catholic, here in Harare, in Masingo Reformed Church University, in Matabele and South, Solus University, in Mutare, Africa University. Which one are we leaving? And then in Pindura, Zegu. These are churches. They say our membership will support, you know, dollar per member, our global faith community and partners will support, blah, 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 and we buy into that. It's only women university in Africa which operates near UZ, but should be in Marondera, right? Which is not a church university, it's a trust. And they also say our partners and what, you know. If they dare say our students will pay enough and what, we'll tell them no. If it's churches, we will be tempted to say, ah, go to hell. But we know they want to go to heaven. So they will say, no, our members are going to pass. And we hold them back. And we are saying, by extension, the government can't turn around and say, one university per province, one polytechnic per province, one industrial training and testing center per province, but see whether the community is there, the parents and the guardians can, you know. No, it's not that kind of business, especially in an economy like this. But what will happen with these institutions, the private ones, the universities, in an industrialized and modernized Zimbabwe with a competitive, well-performing economy is another story. We're not there. So we have to deal with what is before us. No one can start and run a proper university based on tuition fees in this economy.
During Zimdev's presentation, they said in 2014 they collected 41 million. In 2015 they collected 39 million. 2016, 36 million. So the resources are basically dwindling.
Yes.
And at the time the resources are going down, that is when we are also adding another mandate, which is policy driven, that is the STEM initiative. Now, isn't it the time we have to look at cost cutting? The ZIMDEV CEO was very good at talking about a digital economy. Now, when we're talking in terms of a digital economy, we're basically talking of computerization, we're basically talking of harnessing technology in order to drive that economy. All this we are doing, the effort we are doing to try and advertise STEM, putting up a website and putting all the information we want on there, advising headmasters or the Minister of Primary and Education and say, everything is on our website. Registration, everything, digitalizing it. Won't that cut costs? And then the cost savings is now channeled towards the actual program itself. Won't that make a difference to the ministry? And I know you have been very successful in terms of launching programs, and I know that. Everything is, I've never seen a program that you have launched that has failed. It has gone very well. But trying to digitalize whatever we are doing will save a lot of costs for the ministry and whatever. And then the saved costs will go towards the actual program itself. And then during some other presentation, oral evidence that we had, some of your members from the ministry, especially the nanotechnology division, we're crying for a piece of machine that will make a difference to them. And they were saying, look, if only we could get this machine, these are the miracles we'll perform in so far as our research and in so far as launching new programs and so forth, STEM related. And I am thinking, can't we just pay some money and then we finance this research equipment that they require for the benefit of our nation, because they're actually saying they're sending their researchers to South Africa, and it's now benefiting the South Africans, not even us. Minister, don't you think it is critical that you put priority on that machinery and then get it running? My last question. I'm from Masungu. GZU graduations are in October, towards the end of last week of October every year. So students who finish in that particular year don't graduate. So they only have to wait for a year in order for them to graduate. I brought this to the teacher of the ministry, and I've seen this year there was a repetition. So students who finished in 2016 are only going to graduate in 2017. 2017 students who are finishing their studies this year are only going to graduate in 2018. So they have to wait a full year for them to actually graduate. When you take minister, you have to do something about it. Last year, MSU, you had to hold two graduations in the summer that did not manage to graduate because of changes in the dates. Those are my three questions that I have.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Honorable Deputy Chair. With regard to your first question about the budget, I notice and appreciate that this has been a constant, persistent line you have taken as Deputy Chair in today. You really are exercised about prioritization of the limited funding that's available in the budget, and you rightly point out how it has been declining, the collections, from 2014, 2015, in the last year. But I also am glad that you are aware that when there are new priorities, it means that other things should be forgotten. We are not adding something while keeping what was there the way it was. For example, we haven't finalized the budget, the Zimdev budget for 2017, precisely because of this. And I'm glad that directors are here, that when we finalize sometime this week, we will point to your intervention. Mm-hmm. When nobody even knew there was Zimte, we now must let go what is not necessary that we were doing, and to do what we may think is now necessary. We are having this debate, but the fact that we didn't conclude, it means we are respecting each other, because there are quite some serious arguments in favor of keeping what we've been doing. But we can't keep our cake and eat it at the same time. So we appreciate that intervention, but I want to assure you, the concern you raise with regard to this particular point is a shared one. We have to see what is the best and take into account that the revenue is not only pending, but it's small. What is also important, is to recognize that we don't have a Zimdev magic solution, that everything will be resolved through a Zimdev. This is a very small fund. And what we are saying now is that we want to prioritize the support of high-end skills. And try and see what else we're going to do with the other stuff. We have to change, we have to stigmatize ourselves and see maybe there are some things we were doing which we should not do or which we should do differently. But we are very clear that the limited funding available to Zimdev must be towards the training, the research, development, planning and training of high-end skills. That we are very sure about, you know. However, we are also sure we need to look for resources elsewhere. If we can't get them from the fiscals, we must be innovative and see what else our higher and tertiary education as knowledge institutions that must produce new ideas, solutions, and patent these ideas, and claim intellectual property on these ideas, and exploit that intellectual property through manufacturing, incubating new industries, or licensing, and things like that. The universities are facing new challenges.
But I'm happy to report to you that the way they're engaging us and the conversations we're having, they are hearing to go. But Kumanya was, especially when we're dealing with things like this. ZINDEF budget is not a Ramazonke budget. You, at any given time, you must prioritize. So we are going to prioritize. That means other things are not going to be supported under that budget, and we will need to look elsewhere for to support those things. I don't know, Honorable Chair, what machinery or even machine or equipment somebody came here and complained or cried about. I don't know whether you care to be specific.
I think we were looking at nanotech.